suspect and that the girls were guilty. Of course, the question is, on top of this, how were the guys punished? Teased up until the point of death, revived with cold water, whipped again, to be teased 2 or 3 times until they were finally killed off. Now, that would be very good incentive. Taking 2 hours, 3 hours, or the whole day to be killed did not go anywhere near these girls, no matter how beautiful they might have been. Now, those eternal flames, or so-called eternal flames, the embodiment of the goddess Minerva, actually still exist on the other side of that building right there. You see the white building, so-called the typewriter or the wedding cake? On the other side, there are 2 flames burning. They're taken care of by virgin military men 24 hours a day. I don't know if they're virgins or not, but in any case, they burn right there, and that's how the Italians still remind us that they're the center of the world and that the gods are still in their favor. So I always say if it makes them feel better, they can have those burning in those same patterns, in those same paths, avoiding hills in the same direction. Now, this is La Via Sacra. These stones were cut and placed here 2,500 years ago, and I did not mention this before, but the surface would have been smooth enough back in the day for someone to have roller skated across it blindfolded. Of course, they didn't have roller skates. Of course, they wouldn't have done it. The Forum, that in the 2nd century AD, Emperor Hadrian actually outlawed public traffic coming through here during the day. Also, the wear of feet. Now, not just tourist feet over the years, but also the wear of the feet of Mark Anthony, Brutus, Caesar, Augustus, St. Peter, St. Paul, Nero, Caligula, anyone important, or for that matter, not at all important in Roman history, has stood on these stones where we get to stand today. That's a privilege in being in Rome. Now, as I said, in LA, I can reach down, see the Hollywood sign. Wow, 75 years old. We're so incorporated. Touch some of what your heritage is. Now, you should be surprised if you're not from Jerusalem, Greece, or India. In any case, if you turn around in this direction, you'll see one of the most important temples in history. Those are the foundations of the temple of the divine Julius Caesar. Behind that wall of blocks right there is an altar that was set up in the Ides of March 44 BC on an emergency basis. What happened during that time? Anyone? Yell out. No trick questions, by the way. Now, what they did is took his body across town from a half mile away from here, put it on this altar, and proceeded to actually burn him, cremate him in front of 15,000 Romans in the largest fire that the Forum had ever seen. He was deified after that, becoming the second man to be deified in Roman history after Romulus, the founder of Rome. Now, after that, he was known as the living god. That started the deification process, where you'd have one man on top of that hill in the Beverly Hills of Rome, living up in the palaces, that would have been the Palatine Hill, and ruling over millions of others. Now, the man that caused this transition between the Republican phase over to the Imperial phase, he's in question right now. That he still wears his haircut after 2,044 years. Just props. I had it before I shaved it a little bit more. Okay, in any case, so we eat Caesar salad all over the place. Streets in every city of the world named after Julius Caesar. You have kids at the age of 5 knowing something about him and knowing what he stood for. Julius Caesar does not die in our memory. I'm still standing here 3 times a day in the heat, as sunburned as I get, yelling about the man. 2,044 years after his death. If you take a look behind that wall of blocks there, at the altar, you see flowers on top of it. I guarantee you. It's not that I went in before the tour, but in the last 320 days that I've been coming down to the Forum, I have never seen that altar without flowers on it. If you come here the 15th of March, any year on his death date, you see so many flowers throughout this whole area, you cannot see the ground that you're walking on. Now, they still respect him. Not that they respect him as a living god, but they see that their life would not be the same without that man. Now, he's born in 100 BC to middle-class families. Caesar wasn't rich, he wasn't poor, he wasn't intelligent, he wasn't dumb. His only claim to fame at the time of his birth was being a descendant of the goddess Venus, the goddess of love. But a lot of Romans claimed to be descendants of the gods and goddesses, so it didn't make him too special anyway. He had something, though. Charisma. Now, he made his first real mark in his early 20s as a lawyer. He won every single case, but rather than keeping the money for himself, he gave it back to the Roman people in the form of free parties right here, consisting of free food and free entertainment for about 1,000 of his closest friends. It was during that time that Rome was a city of 1.1 million people. Word would be expanding all around the city and might have sounded like this. Hey man, you heard of Julius Caesar? Have I heard of Julius Caesar? Man, I was just at his party. And supposedly of the people and for the people, but really neither. They saw him and saw something that they didn't have. They saw a charismatic man growing in fame and power very quickly. They decided if they were not going to have an enemy, they were going to need to make him a friend. They soon did that by buying him out. They made him the mayor of Rome. During the time that Caesar was the mayor of Rome, he would have been known as the front man of Rome. When someone thought of Rome, they thought of Caesar. When someone thought of Caesar, they thought of Rome. He was commissioned to throw parties for up to 15,000 of his closest friends. All right, no, they weren't. 13,000 to crash the party, but it was in his name. People so close together in the square, they couldn't have breathed. piling up on top of the four hills in every single direction. Free food and free entertainment. That's, of course, when we bring that into question. Sort of motive, a phrase that was up his sleeve, that became very popular in the following years, called bread and circuses. It's the reason that you have one emperor living over millions of others without questioning them as a living god. The reason that games in the color we do. Now, the ones that are popular, you understand that that popularity breeds contempt and jealousy. I can name a guy that I work with. Threat. Got rid of him, sending him off to war twice in what is today modern-day Spain. He came back twice victorious, unharmed. They finally said, listen, Caesar, you're so good at everything you freaking do. Why don't you go fight a war that matters to us? They sent him off to Gaul, an area that had never been conquered by the Romans, including Holland, Belgium, Germany, and France, parts of each of those countries. Now, he was sent on a mission impossible. It was impossible for him to win this war, it was said. He had too few arms and too few men. The Senate did not think they'd ever be seeing him again. He told them not to come back until they had the Vercingetorix, the Belgian leader, alive. Now, within a year, they saw a ghost walking down a road that we see on the night tour. It's been preserved. He went in front of the Senate building and had something to say. First, he put Vercingetorix alive in a prison where St. Peter and St. Paul were later held. He began to distribute the jewels from the victory in the state of military arrest, calling himself dictator for a period of 2 years. It was the maximum period that a man could be dictator during the Republic. After 2 years, of course, Rome had the big question mark, one of the largest in history. What would they do after that? Would they go on to being a dictatorship or back to being a republic? Caesar was the only one that had his mind made up. He went up on the rostrum and began to speak to the people, saying, listen, I've been a pretty good dictator, have I not? They're like, yeah, Caesar, we had a lot of fun, free food, free games, free drinks, it was great. So what do you think I make myself dictator for life? Now, what you guys need to understand is that the vast majority of Romans at the time, and probably we would have as well, would have loved to have lived the last years partying under Julius Caesar. But there were 34 men in particular who hated this idea. There were 11% of the 300 senators saw him as the end to their power. They called an emergency Senate meeting with Caesar a half mile away from here, or 1 kilometer, at the Theater of Pompeii, the ruins of which are buried underneath the modern-day Campo di Fiori. As Caesar walked into that meeting, he was handed a note. Now we're going to be walking in this direction for the sake of me not fainting and for the sake of you not fainting. To the shade, and with the backdrop of the forum, we're going to go over his death and talk about why we still talk about him. After you have three columns that may look familiar. If they do look familiar, you've probably seen them from sketches of the forum from the 1700s and 1800s. During that time, as I said, the forum was mainly covered in with the ruins from the ancient monuments, mud, and cow dung. About a third of these columns would have been visible, and what's hard to imagine is that some houses would have been constructed right on top of the so-called cow pasture. That would have been someone's backdoor view to come out and take a look at these columns, these undying reminders of the past, history, and heritage sitting right underneath them. You still have that opportunity in Rome. You've got the ancient monuments mixed with the modern monuments. Look at Piazza della Rotonda, all the way from the Pantheon up to McDonald's. Very well blended. Now, you smell something bad, anyone?
Yes.
Been pausing up until now. Smelling the oldest sewer system in the world. This area would have been marshland in 600 BC. It was drained along this canal into the Tiber River and was solidified 2,500 years ago, being called the
corner of it there.
Now that was the platform from which anyone who was anyone who had anything important to say back in the day would have spoken. The likes of Cicero, Virgil, Mark Anthony, Brutus, got some stuff to cover. In any case, this guy was caught. Folded up the note, said anything that could possibly be written on, I already know. Put it in his pocket and continued into the meeting. Inside, he was greeted by what he did not expect. 34 knives held by 34 very angry senators. Now, he received his first stab in the back. That was the stab of Cassius. He pulled it out and began to fight back. But what man back in the day without the aid of automatic weapons could fight back against 34 men? He was doomed to failure. Not many could have. Now, he lost all hope when he turned around, felt a stab in his back, and looked into the eyes of a man who was believed to have been his illegitimate son. Who was that?
Brutus,
exactly. He turned around and did not say, I know everybody knows that, you're welcome to Rome. Turned around and said, did not say, et tu, Brute. Those are the words of William Shakespeare in Latin. He actually turned around and said, tu qua que file me Brute, rend you to Brutus, my son. Shakespeare also told us that he died on the steps of the Senate building. Of course, we found out later that it was struck by lightning in 46 BC and was in the process of reconstruction. In any case, in its epitome of betrayal, Caesar fell to his knees, spread his toga along the ground, and said that he put the hood of his cloak over his head, dying an honorable death next to the statue of his nemesis, Pompey. Now, word shot out all across the city in every direction. Caesar's dead. He's been assassinated, but always changing as to why he's been assassinated and who would have assassinated a great man like Caesar. It was the mass confusion, 44 BC, Ides of March, the forum filled up with 15,000 people demanding to know what had happened to Caesar. As it filled up, Brutus had the nerve to be dragging Caesar's body across the city. As it arrived here at the Rostra, where he would later speak, Caesar's toga was probably so bloody not a spot of white on it was visible. He began to speak to the people, among other things, saying how Caesar was a megalomaniac, how he's ambitious, how he just wanted to be a dictator, make slaves of all of us. And he really made the very prominent statement, who of you would rather be a slave under Caesar, would you not rather be a free man under the Republic? I love Caesar, but I love Rome more. Now, Rome, being the flocks of sheep that there were, actually began to say, thank you so much. Hail Brutus. Thank you so much for getting rid of this madman, Julius Caesar. Brutus should have picked up his toga and went on to rule Rome, but he didn't. He stepped off to the side and called up a young man to speak. Anyone ever heard of Mark Antony? Okay. We don't still remember him today because of the fact that he stood up there and said something really tear-jerking about Caesar, who was believed to have been his best friend, and that all the Romans afterwards cried on each other's shoulders, and now people still cry when they think of it. No, he said what's believed to have been today the most passionate and persuasive speech in history, because he caused a 180-degree shift in Rome, eventually causing the Roman Empire. Now, what was said up there on that day has been lost forever. In other words, we have absolutely no idea. Of all the useless speeches that were preserved, we have no idea what he said. Who helped us out to reconstruct it, though? Who lives after them? Well, the good is often turned with their bones. So let it be with Caesar. The noble Brutus hath told you Caesar was ambitious. If it were true, it were a grievous fault. And grievously has Caesar answered it. Here under leave of Brutus and the rest. For Brutus is an honorable man. So are they all honorable men. Come I to speak in Caesar's funeral. He was my friend, faithful and just to me. But Brutus says he was ambitious, and Brutus is an honorable man. He brought many captives home to Rome, whose ransoms did the general coffers fill. Did in this Caesar seem ambitious? When the poor have cried, Caesar hath wept, ambition surely should be made of sterner stuff. But Brutus says he was ambitious, and sure, Brutus is an honorable man. You all did see that on the Lupercal, I did thrice present him with the kingly crown, which he did thrice refuse. Was this ambition? I speak not to disprove what Brutus here spoke, but here I am to speak what I do. People still saw them as the greatest of friends. He saw it as a perfect opportunity to leap up there on the roster and snatch all the power that the best friend Caesar of his had lost the moment he'd been assassinated. The man was successful in the definition of the word, because he became a ruler of Rome along with two other men. He was a dictator along with Lepidus and along with a very underestimated young man, Octavian, Caesar's nephew and adoptive son. Octavian, what was there to worry about him? He was 16 years old, Caesar's nephew, so what? Well, at the age of 18, he went into the Senate building and changed history forever. He made a lament over Caesar, eventually causing the deification process of Caesar, building that temple over the spot where the man had been cremated 2 years previous. Caesar became known as a living god, or as a god, right up there with Jupiter, right up there with Antoninus Pius, right up there with all the rest. Now, finally, what Octavian did is went back to the Senate building and made another lament, saying, listen, Caesar's a god? Well, I'm his nephew. Check it out. My uncle, his blood runs through my veins. Does that not make me a living god as well? Now, with this perfect and pristine Roman reasoning, Star Wars saga began. Octavian ruled for a whopping 34 years, changed his name to Caesar Augustus. In the process of that rule, he did two things. One, sort of insignificant. He said on his deathbed, I found Rome a city of bricks, I leave it a city of marble. He gave Rome a total makeover. Two, he gave Rome a total political makeover because he caused the Roman Empire, which went on to flourish for another 450 years, just a couple defects, spreading Roman culture all around the Mediterranean, North Africa, and Europe. And that is a rock-solid reason that we now live the lives that we do today in the places that we do today with the cultures that we do today. Speaking about politics, our politics all the way throughout Australasia, South Africa, Britain, and the Americas come from this building. The Pope today holds the name of the Pontifex Maximus, the religious high priest of ancient Rome. You'll see Pont Max written all over the place. English, among tons of other languages that are 100% Latin-derived, is 60% Latin-derived. And, of course, bread and circuses. If you think they died out with Julius Caesar, definitely have to think again. If you forgot in the heat, your mouth is dry as mine, why you came down to Rome, what you're doing here anyway, and why these monuments are important, and what have they have to do with antiquity, well, that's my job, to remind you that we're standing right now in one of the major heritage spots of the Western world, that without the forum here, without all these stories that we've just gone over, we'd be living a life nowhere near to the life that we're living today. Now, I've come from a collection of young interested in thank you.
Pantheon. This is the Pantheon. Where the rain comes in.
Thank you. thing.
One, two, three, four, five. Gotcha. That's good.
Beata Vergine del Buon Consiglio in Petosino di Sorisole. Santa Maria Ausiliatrice in Lodi. Santo Stefano, Santi Pietro e Paolo, Sant'Anna in Tradate. Santa Maria Assunta in Villanova sull'Arda. Sant'Antonio Abate in Canneto sull'Oglio. Sant'Andrea, Natale del Signore, San Benedetto in Torino. San Lorenzo in Cavour. San Francesco alla Rizzottaglia in Novara. San Bernardo.
Thank you.
All who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified self with all its passions and its desires. Since we are living by the Spirit, let our behavior be guided by the Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Erfüllen. Denn die Frucht des Geistes ist Liebe, Freude, Friede, Langmut, Freundlichkeit, Güte, Treue.
Hermanos, por mi parte os digo, si vivís según el Espíritu, no daréis satisfacción a las apetencias de la carne. En cambio, el fruto del Espíritu es amor, alegría, paz, paciencia, afabilidad, bondad.
L'ultima sera della sua vita terrena, Gesù promette per 5 volte il dono dello Spirito Santo. Nello stesso luogo, la sera di Pasqua, il risorto si presenta davanti agli apostoli e le fonte lo Spirito promesso con gesto simbolico della risale e con le parole ricevete lo Spirito Santo. 50 giorni dopo, sempre nel Cenacolo, lo Spirito Santo irrompe con la sua potenza, trasformando i Galati che abbiamo appena ascoltato, delinea il frutto dello Spirito, elencando una gamma molteplice di virtù che sbocciano nell'esistenza del fedele. Lo Spirito Santo è alla radice dell'esperienza di fede. Infatti, nel battesimo noi siamo resi figli di Dio proprio mediante lo Spirito, che voi siete figli nelle prove. Fatto, afferma ancora San Paolo, che Dio ha mandato nel nostro cuore, nei nostri cuori, lo Spirito del suo Figlio che grida Abba, Padre. L'intera vicenda del cristiano dovrà togliersi allora